All right, we're back, guys. Now we're just taking a quick break while players move around the board. But I bring this back so that I can get us caught up, because a couple of moves have been made during that break, one of which was Neeb actually claiming a land instead of actually going for a fight. So this was a bit unexpected for me. Not like, oh my god, what crazy turn of events have happened, but I really thought they were going to send Neeb into the fray, as Neeb is once again probably the best player, one of the best players at least, playing in the tournament, much less on their team. Drogo, though, really showing that he has got the chops when it comes to PvP, as he's won both his series today, but also just in general been a badass when it comes to playing on the board. But, okay, so that's advanced there, and then it looks like they're sending Showtime to attack Drogo?
Yeah, exactly.
Okay, so round two. Boink, boink. So to be clear how this works, guys, Showtime uses his movement to move into Puck's tile, and then uses his action to attack into Drogo. So, rematch Areno.
Oh boy.
Now, really quick, to explain how long each of these days go, each of the casts and each of the sessions for the Civil War has been ballpark 4-ish hours. This looks to be heading about that direction. And like we said, we have some plans to advance things faster. So for next time, next day, players will be able to move two tiles at a time. Then the next day after that, people will maybe be able to do something else crazy, which I don't want to reveal. And again, this isn't something that will go on forever, but it is something that we're plenty happy casting as much of it as we can. But let me move this over here. We're not necessarily saying it's the reason why, but Drogo sold some shirts today. Maybe it's giving him power? I should check out the Teespring campaigns while you can, guys. Again, 13 shirts sold for Team Drogo, 17 for Team Harstam. We want to try and sell 25 for each team's total, if possible, but again, not the end of the world if we don't.
Oh, I definitely invited both of them.
Oh, okay. Hopefully,
comes back. And they were like, nope.
No, thank you.
Okay.
I love Joker's response, by the way. He's like, wait, what? Why? Again? But unfortunately, that's the thing about the center tile. Like, they're really... It's interesting, because when I look at the board, I look at it, I think, in a different aspect than these guys are. And I actually don't think so much about putting emphasis on that middle tile. If anyone ever played a game called Shattered Galaxy back in the day... God, I love referencing this. It makes me feel old. They had something called the crater, which was essentially the middle tile on the board over there, which is without a doubt, by the way, where I got some of the influence for this tournament and this game and this format. But the point of it is, you learned quickly how not influential that piece of the board was, but it was such a because it was the center, it was so attractive, and everyone kept always attacking into it. And you realize this is just wasting everyone's time. So for me, I would be completely fighting along the outskirts of the map, but never even touch that middle tile if it was up to me. But rematch Reno, best of five again, featuring Showtime.
Drogo needs to eat a banana, so that's what we're waiting
is
on.
Is that a euphemism or?
No, I don't think so.
No, I actually would love a banana. Oh my god, I've been eating apples lately because, you know, trying to be healthy and all that. I hate apples because, like, the skin sometimes gets in your teeth. It's like, whatever. A banana's just nice. You just eat it. It's, like, easy. It's got its own little container. It's peelable. It's awesome. You never have to touch the sticky bits. I love bananas, man.
The downside is that there's a ton of innuendo with it.
That? They also, like, go off really easily. And fucking fruit flies, like,
I hate
crazy.
Bananas because I only like bananas within, like, a 3-4 day max time period. And so you have to first wait to get to that time period for them to stop being a little too green, that, you know.
Yeah. Right. Oh, that's the worst. You buy bananas, you're like, okay, I gotta wait a day or two. And then 2 days later, you're like, I don't really feel like bananas anymore. So then you don't eat them for 2 days, and then all of a sudden they're bad.
And then they're just brown. Yeah, exactly. See, that's what's worse about bananas.
Brown bananas are only good for one thing, too, and that's like making banana bread. And I don't even want banana bread. I buy bananas because I want a banana, not because I want to, like, cook the banana into something else.
If our bananas go bad, we freeze them to make into banana bread later.
Well, I was making jokes, but, you know, I'm just saying Harstam's team hasn't sold any t-shirts, and both Puck and Showtime lost. Drogo has sold, I think, two t-shirts over the broadcast, I'm just saying, guys, if you're part of Team Drogo and you want him to keep winning, give him some more of that t-shirt love. But we are going to hop into Rack Sheeran. It is the rematch all over again. The funny thing about this, though, is like this back-to-back aspect of this happening is only made possible through the randomness of the turn order. This is something where this may not have actually been an option had there been a different randomization of the team order.
Mm-hmm.
And to explain, I guess, that aspect before we do the players, because you know who we're watching. This just became like a best of 11, by the way, essentially. But every turn that finishes doesn't make a new order of which players can move and act, but every day will. So it's never been the same twice, and the next time we come back for day 4 and day 5, it'll be different orders every time. But spawning down here in the bottom right of Rakshir, we've got Mind Sanity's current badass. He is 2-0 in overall wins. See if he can make a 3-0. It's Drogo for the Templar.
In the top left as the Red Protoss, he is Showtime, the Tall Dream.
It's just kind of cool. I wish you could add titles like that to players, right? Like, I feel if you do something like Drogo, winner of Dream Hacks, like, it doesn't sound really cool, but it's like Drogo of the Templar. That actually sounds kind of badass.
You guys are introducing them like, you know, old-fashioned, like, Greek introductions or whatever.
Oh, man, hang on.
Son of blank, winner of blank.
Oh, my God. That would actually be pretty awesome. I would love to do intros like that. Like, straight up get the horn out. It's like heralding and a knight's tale and stuff like that. But quick shout-outs to who has just become my new favorite moderator on Base Trade TV, Lord Isium. Apparently knows what Shattered Galaxy is. Yeah.
Nerd.
Whatever, man. It was my first... I played that but shortly after I discovered StarCraft. And StarCraft was a lot harder for me to play, so I enjoyed Shattered Galaxy more.
Yeah, that sounds about right. That's why I play Age of Mythology.
Yeah.
Brood War, this is hard. Especially, well, N64 Vanilla, actually, was hard.
Well, you know, the irony I kind of go with you, people talk about how hard and difficult Brood War is. I'm like, how hard can it be if all the people retire and go play that, right?
Like,
Of course, it's a much different game. Despite it being the same lineage of StarCraft, so it's kind of hard. It's like it's comparing apples and oranges, or bananas and brown bananas.
Oh no, it's harder. There's no argument. But 6 years of Team Liquid arguments. Nope.
So, but okay. So here's my opinion. This is coming from someone who didn't play Brood War, right? So I'm not saying I'm at all knowledgeable in this topic, but from playing it a couple of times, having played the custom games forever. The game, I feel, is only more difficult because it's clunkier. And I feel like if you had a version of Brood War that was... and I know it's impossible to do, but it was still Brood War, but with the smoothed outness, with the group controls, with the better aspects of StarCraft, not design or balance-wise, but like UI and, I guess, control-wise, I feel like Brood War would not be the harder game.
I still think it would. Like, the economy, the way that works in StarCraft, which actually relies on the AI being dumb, but still, let's say it worked the same way. If everything else was fixed, there's more spread out games in Brood War, and the battles are still slower. So I feel like there's always more to do.
So that's the thing. I can't say that I agree with that because the battles may be slower as a result of the clunkiness. Like, for example, trying to cut firewood with an axe is harder than cutting firewood with
actually,
a chainsaw. But does that mean it's better?
Not just because of the actual user engagement, but just that like through the actual interaction between the units are slower. So, I mean,
I don't know.
We could debate this for like hours.
Yeah, it's not a topic worth debating. I just, difference of opinions on this. But anyways, so to start off, we got 3 probe kills for Showtime. Not too bad. This is weird to note, but it is an improvement considering every time the Adepts have come in, it's been 2 probes. Getting one extra doesn't exactly show weakness or drug, and you're like, oh my god, is he starting to fall apart? But it is nice to see something change for Showtime, because that last series, despite the fact that it did go back and forth, did always feel like it was better for Drogo. I'm not sure if you got that same sort of feel out of it.
Oh, really? I thought it felt better than for Showtime.
Hmm. Okay, Brood War, calm down.
Yeah, I'm just full of contradictions today. I'm just actually... I don't believe anything I'm saying. I just want to like be like, nope, Rifkin.
So you're just going to disagree with everything I say?
Nope.
Okay, so what if I said we need feminism?
Nope.
My brain just exploded out of my skull right now. I can't believe you... What I can't believe isn't what the statement, but that you committed to the bit. Like, that blows me away even more.
Commit. I'm not afraid of commitment. Anyway.
She says no, and she's not afraid of commitment. All right. Blink coming up for both players. We got upgrades a little bit favorable for Showtime. It's still a pretty similar way to open as far as strategy goes, but I think a lot of this really starts coming different directions when you see after Blink, like, is it Charge that goes with this, or is it Disruptors? Like, what direction does this actually end up going? If Drogo's heading towards Disruptors, he's not going to need upgrades as badly as somebody like Showtime, who may invest in, say, Adepts or Charge Lots afterwards.
Yeah, Showtime's going for Charge Lots quite frequently.
Yeah. And that's the only reason I bring this up, too, because if you see Blink and a Robo, you immediately think Blink, Stalker, Disruptor. It's the way the game always goes. But Showtime's not been necessarily going down that path.
Yeah, I mean, both these guys haven't really been trying that. Like, Puck tried it, right? And he died for it. You know, whenever he would transition, Drogo would either already have a lead and just extend it, or, like, kill him as he tried. But for these guys, it's Drogo kind of committing to pre-Disruptor for the most part. There was obviously a couple games where he actually did get Disruptor, but pre-Disruptor. So Blinkstalker, Immortal, and then Adepts. That's right. And then Showtime's been going either Phoenix Opener or Oracle Opener, and then Charge Lot Archon, Immortal. He's got Blink before, as he has it now, and then still transferred over into Charge, so I'm still not sure he's not, you know, still planning on doing that.
That's kind of the interesting aspect where we talk about, like, Korean strategies versus foreigner strategies, right? Everyone foreign scene looks up to Koreans, and they all try to make Charge Lot, Zealot, Archon, etc. work. But unfortunately, out of position. You're going to lose that pylon right away. Nexus already in a lot of danger. No chance to cancel this anymore. Showtime, if he's paying more attention, going to force field that off. But he's going to recall instead. Play it safe.
Hmm. Oh, yeah. It's pretty safe. Would have been really nice for him to get that Nexus, but good reaction from Drogo. Drogo's trying to get to his upgrades as well, and Showtime has not started Charge, so I guess this is going to go into Disruptors eventually, although still no one committing to Robotics Bay. Oh, Drogo is right now. And I gotta imagine Showtime starts one soon, too, unless he's gonna try and kill Drogo while he transitions, kind of like revenge for Puck.
Oh yeah, I kind of forgot Puck was that first one who played today.
So, the time here for Drogo is actually, like, he's the one that would want more time to get to those double disruptor production, but Showtime is the one that's actually on the defensive here. I don't know if this is dangerous from Drogo, but it is also a smart idea to keep Showtime from pushing away, make Showtime feel like he has to defend. Okay, he's actually just going to back off. Force fields could have made things really disastrous. I think that everyone is afraid of right there.
Yeah, without Archons in play, no easy way to break it. I would love to almost do a balance test type thing and see if Hallucinate Archons could break force fields. Would that drastically change the way PvP went? Like, you'd still need sentries to make said hallucinations, but are force fields no longer as big of a deal? I don't know. Regardless, though, both boys getting caught a little bit. I'd say Drogo getting caught a little bit worse, actually. Those sentries all stuck on the front lines, but nothing here to really fight. Warp Prism on that front line as well, going to get folks down by the overcharge. Has to move away immediately, so cancels the warp in. Two Disruptors on the way for Drogo. Looks like he should be able to buy the time, but can they walk to the front lines in time?
And this is really eerily similar to their first game played on this map. Just a few different changes, but it's actually still going to be the aggressor. It's going to change. This time the aggressor, Showtime, is the one that looks like he's about to win. Disruptors do pop out, get a good shot on the Immortals, bringing them to very, very low health. The other one's trying to get sniped. Oh, it is. Oh,
with that denial, there's no way to deal with the other four Immortals, and they're all so low. Probe's getting pulled. Last Warp coming out of Drogo, but need to remind you, Zombie Grub, Drogo does best when he loses at first.
Well, I mean, he won the last time. He won the first game last series, then won the series. So, I mean, this is the reverse. Oh, wait, did he? No, wait.
He started off 0-1, didn't he? I'm pretty sure he did.
Yeah, you're right. I keep getting, like, because Showtime is the one that's attacking in the exact same position that Drogo attacked last Best of 5.
Yeah, it is a little bit confusing. Mixing me up. Give you that.
Damn it. Okay, so you're right. There you go.
But even with the Disruptors coming out, someone clip that, by the way, for me, please. Even with the disruptors coming out, it's not enough to stop this. The third base going down is pretty devastating. He lost the probes to pull in hopes of defending it, and even then, it dies.
This is game.
Yeah.
Drogo is going to have to kill like 90% of the army, and then counterattack, and okay, he could do something then. It's going to be hard to kill 90% of this army, even with four good disruptor shots. Yeah, you blink on top, suddenly it's more of a circle. And
yeah, folks firing them down. Not bad at all. Showtime, we'll take game number one in this second best of five, this immediate rematch of the players. But we'll see if he can continue the momentum. I do want to throw out, like, for Drogo's series that he won, I want to take nothing away from Drogo. He did play very well in the PvP. But there was that one game that was a bit of a giveaway in Orbital, like a bit of a freebie, if you will. And I'm wondering if we'll see, with that mistake made, would Showtime have even had that go to the ace match type thing? Either way, guys, we're going to hop off to a small break while we get game two set up. Please stick with us. Check out the t-shirt sales, !! Teespring in chat, and we'll see you soon. Okay, we're back just in time for those beeps to get going. You guys can hear that countdown. It's Dusk Towers was Drogo's map pick for the loser's pick scenario. Of course, it's been renamed to Ember Towers, which is the cooler reskin version. The city is quite literally on fire.
Literally on fire.
And the nice thing about this is, well, Blizzard, again, not that it's their fault or anything, but they have to kind of dumb down a lot of the maps texture-wise and remove a lot of cool doodads because they have to make StarCraft 2 accessible to all, including the really terrible computers out there. We're not limited to that, and we get to see really cool details thanks to Avex. But spawning here in the upper right side of the reskinned Dusk Towers, he is currently down one in the series. Ladies and gentlemen, representing the Templar, it's My Insanity's PT Drogo.
In the bottom left, as the red Protoss, he is Showtime.
Okay, well, the probe comes across the map, and it's not going to get that super sick kill. It's a small detail, but what Drogo's done by leaving the probe on the outside is force that probe to fight it. And it sounds so silly, but it's so much better than having your pylon drastically be brought down to almost dead.
Yeah, it's pretty crucial. It's also very important on the timing here, as, you know, this time Showtime couldn't get his own pylon in there to block it off. That was also a problem. So these guys are chipping away, but I don't think it's going to get the... It might get into the orange, but not the red and almost dead.
Certainly, yeah. It's not getting the timing it did in the past. Real quick, everyone's asking about the prize pool and whatnot. This is an ongoing tournament. It's day three out of question mark days. There's currently $1,600 in prizing made available thanks to Yord Woodwatches. Again, go to woodwatches.com/base if you haven't. It sounds so silly. I know you don't care, but we want you guys signed up for these links. There's a chance to win $150 through a code giveaway, and they do ship all over the place, so make sure to enter while you can. Get a free watch or get a super expensive watch for really cheap. I don't care what you do, it's your money, you can do what you like. But $150 code is available and will be announced live here at the end of the stream. So you gotta consider, like, here's your options, guys, right? Let's say there's about 150 people entered in. I guarantee you half of those people will not be here live at the end of the broadcast because that's happened every time we've run draws so far. We've had to redraw the winner like 5 or 7 times. So your chances to win this are not too bad. I would definitely say enter into that. And all you gotta do is fill out the form as if you were requesting the $20 code off for the Father's Day sale, but then scroll down a little bit further and enter your Twitch name. And I'm gonna see if I can get numbers to see where we're at for that while the pylon slowly doesn't die.
Right? Like, okay. It actually did get into the red, but not as close as did last time, so still. We do have, I suppose, both Stargates going down, and that's pretty interesting. Showtime has not been shy about Stargates, but Drogo has, so... Oh, this is what I think we were talking about last time, that pylon's almost dead. If that Zealot had that same timing, it would have one-shot the other pylon and actually would have gotten in, maybe?
Yeah, Mothership Pro, whatever. Maybe. But the thing about this is he's going to eventually want to tear this down anyways himself, so in a small, weird way, Showtime helps him.
Yeah, kind of, yeah. Well, as I was saying, the double Stargate, or the Stargate for each player, rather, is going to be interesting, especially because when this happens, it does commonly lead into Phoenix versus Phoenix Wars, especially if there's any scouting going down. Because basically, once, like, one person sees the Stargate, another person sees that they saw the Stargate, they both kind of have to go for Phoenixes, because what if one of them goes for an Oracle, another one, so on and so forth, right? So, they don't know, but they are both getting Phoenixes, And that's still going to lead to a potential Phoenix War. Like, they're going to just have to keep on making Phoenixes and try and win that way.
Small shout out goes to Andy Vo, by the way. Andy Vo _ says, "Hey, Rifkin, I've always watched your videos on YouTube, and this is my first time on your stream. That's awesome to hear, dude." Our YouTube, though, as a quick note, oh, the big scout on this Phoenix because he's going for his own. We're going to have some Phoenix War zombie grub. Oh,
there you go. Confirmed.
Quick note, though, nice username. Nice _ username in chat. It's the guy who manages our YouTube channel. Make sure it looks all pretty and nicely done with the VODs. And he's kind of hanging out in chat with us today. So if you guys haven't checked out our YouTube, first off, it is youtube.com/BaseTradeTV. Go subscribe! But secondly, you can thank him for making the spoiler-free content, the all-in-one videos. Everything on the YouTube that's like a positive thing is a direct result because of him.
Mm-hmm. The YouTube. The tube.
Anyway. Sometimes he says, I sometimes feel like I'm the only commenter on YouTube. Yeah, a lot of, I don't know. The only time we get comments on YouTube is like when people want to start fights, man. Like, we got this one video right now, the flies with honey thing. This one guy has just been like picking fights with everybody in the comments. They started deleting them and they got really upset. They started deleting them, so he commented more. That's like the most commented video we have. Everyone else is like two or three. And I'm not sure what to do to inspire more comments on the videos because we just don't get many.
Yeah. It kind of goes with the number, I suppose, of people that are actually watching it. It's actually very surprising to get people from YouTube to Twitch versus the other way around.
By the way, yeah, a lot of people who are famous on YouTube come over to Twitch and make it easy. It's not so much the other way around. But by the way, while we got this game progressing, I got the updated numbers. Only 60 people have entered in for that watch code, guys. I really don't want to ask our sponsor to give it away if there's less than 100 people entered in. Mostly because, like, again, it's they're giving away something for free that's worth quite a bit of money. I would absolutely say it's worth your guys' while to enter in. It'll take a few seconds of your time, and the emphasis really goes into, once again, that you will not be spammed with emails. They only have it so they can see participation and email you the code for the discount should you actually want to use the $20 off code. But if you win the $150, obviously you won't need the $20 off code.
Yeah. So this is interesting. Drogo stopped going for Phoenixes, and he's obviously going to lose the war now, especially because Showtime's getting a second Stargate and a Fleet Beacon. But he's trying to go into Blink, Stalkers, and DTs. And unfortunately, the DTs aren't going to have too great of a time because the Robo's on the way.
I look at those DTs, and I'm wondering if that's a lot less about the DTs than a lot more on the Archons.
They're warped in offensively.
Oh, okay, you're right. So that's why I saved the pylon. So a couple DTs might get some work done, but the full wall off and a force field make sure that it won't get too out of hand. Anion Pulse Crystal is coming out of Showtime, so he's really expecting this to still go in the direction of Phoenixes, but it will not.
Well, the problem is that it's actually not so much an error on Showtime's part to get this, as it is very risky for Drogo to do anything else but match it.
What?
Oh, okay. Fall in. Okay, that works.
DT's almost killed the pylon that was overcharging.
Hell yeah.
That damage is nuts.
Yeah, it is. But anyways, this is like trying to transition out of like Muta versus Buta. You try going to Festers. Sometimes it does work, and if you can live long enough, it's actually the better composition. But you know, at this point, this many Phoenixes, without Blink especially, for the next like 20 seconds, they can roam around. Even with Blink, counterattacks will always be problems. If Drogo ever decides, like, oh, my army's good enough to attack, let's go, he might lose all of his probes in the process and maybe doesn't break Showtime. So it's still, you know, important for Showtime to see that Drogo's not matching him with Phoenixes. I think he, like, very intentionally started building Immortals instead of, like, I think he was building War Observer or something like that. But anyway. And he's going to have an anti-Blink Stalker ground composition while still having a very strong Phoenix count.
Yeah. Any Pulse Crystals did complete. And while that might not have a huge influence here and now, it's still nice to have. I don't know if it would have been worth canceling. The extra gas could have gone towards like maybe an extra Immortal, but this is Archons now starting up for Drogo, which I really do like. If you're not going to have high Templar trying to feed back Phoenix, for example, Archons can't be lifted, and they got that splash damage because he uses the clump so notoriously. So good answers to have, for certain.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, I guess this game is going to go on to fourth bases. Drogo takes his first, and that's one thing you can definitely do against Phoenix, and that's expand, because they can't build or pick up buildings. Also get some static defense. You know, again, with this many Phoenixes, they're not going to be too worried by one or two cannons, but that might get like a last shot on one of the Phoenixes and start actually culling the number, because Showtime stopped. There is a point of just, you know, even though mass Phoenixes are cool and annoying, just, like, there's not much point to go like above 10. Yeah. He's stuck at 6 right now.
We got a resub, by the way. Thank you very much to NosNeb782 for the 14 months. Long time. Big love.
Thank you. The Mothership Core was sniped. Instantly build. Not a problem. Again, Showtime going for a very anti just Drogo composition here.
And while the game goes slowly, we do have a brand new sub. I love the name. Weird and Perverted. Just subscribe to the channel. I can't talk. I can't wait to talk about being weird and perverted every time this reason happens. Double Robo is coming out of Showtime, so he's really making up for lost time. Triple Robo production is kind of insane, but if he's going to have four base economy, he'll be able to afford it.
Yeah. No problem, really. This has gone away from Air. I mean, what's funny is that Showtime, should this go into a super long PvP, which would be the first time I think we've seen it. No, I take it back. We've definitely seen Tempest before. But still, it could go into Tempest. And of course, Showtime would have a great head start on that. But even if they're taking four bases now, they still aren't near supply capped. Yeah, it's only at like 130 supply.
He's bled out quite a few of these Phoenix, unfortunately. This is something where the Phoenixes are going to be a lot less necessary as time goes on, but I still... That crowd control aspect shouldn't be underestimated. Unless you're at like max out supply and you need to make room for it. Like, don't lose the Phoenix, man.
Yeah, exactly. And they're not max out in supply. So there's also not a big reason to try and get the Tempest or like Mass Air until you're at a pretty decent supply. I'm saying like 180 maxed out. And really advancing tech to that next stage of PvP. Showtime is getting triple immortal production, which would certainly blast through Blink Stalkers, but Drogo stopped building those as soon as he realized he basically had enough to deal with the Phoenix threat. So 19 is still a lot of Blink Stalkers to 8 immortals, but Drogo's trying to get a better composition himself, own charge, his own upgrades.
I'm also wondering if he's going to be investing heavily into those, like how heavy the Archon investment is going to be for these players. Zealots are a pretty big deal considering there's not a lot of splash, there's no storms, there's no nothing to deal with them. And if it's Zealot versus Zealot trading on the front lines, an extra Archon Blast or two can make a world of difference when it comes to the splash damage. But unfortunately, these Zealots, they don't have the cool whirlwind effect that the ones with axes really do. They just look that way.
Yeah. Attacking into the defensively set up Showtime might just lose Drogo the game, similar to the last best of five on this map. Which, once again, they were like reverse position. Showtime was the aggressor, Drogo the defender. I don't know about this. Like, besides the defensive position with, like, Photon Overcharges and Instant Warp-ins and whatnot, although I guess the Warp Prism takes care of that for Drogo, too, it's just a really good composition from Showtime. He's gonna have 11 Immortals. No, he's gonna have 14 Immortals. Sorry, that's the second round of Immortal production.
Yeah, wow. Okay, 12 Immortals. What I consider most about this is not just that it's 12 Immortals to no Immortals. It's 12 Immortals that are all gonna have that barrier ability. So they should be the ones on the front line soaking these hits, even for the Zealots, I would argue.
Yeah, right? The point is, Drogo has a good chunk of almost useless supply. I mean, cool, they sniped an Archon right there, but god, they're not going to hold up against Charge Lot Archon Immortal.
No, and this number count is kind of crazy. A lot of Zealots getting free hits, but Charge Off cooldown comes in. Drogo now slamming on the left side with the Zealots, right side with the Stalkers. Showtime's going to back away into his overcharges. I love this move, because why not fight with that one advantage? It's getting some extra hits. Even the cannon's getting fires shots in, but look at that Immortal count. It's 14 Immortals. It's so stupid to look at.
It's very scary every single time Drogo approaches him with a mass charge lot warp in. I guess it was sniped, though, so not a problem. But whenever there's not charge lots, the Immortals just do so well.
So, I don't even know math, right? Let's take this down easy. Let's assume it's 10, not even 14 Immortals, right? 24 damage a shot. That's like 240 damage per volley. These Archons will go down so quick if focus fired. And then I have an armored units. Armored units like Stalkers, it's going to be a joke. All the Immortals need to do is hits.
I'm surprised that Drogo is taking this fight. I mean, initially, like I said, the charge lots running into Showtime's Immortals made it look like an okay fight, but it's still the problem. If his charge lots go down,
the Mothership
Core won't stand up.
No chance for a recall anymore. He's going to keep pushing into this. Now, this might be where Showtime starts overextending a little bit. Drogo does have five bases. This one finishing up soon. So he'll have the money, and he's had the money for warp-ins and additional reinforcements. As Showtime gets further across the map, that warp prism's not here just yet, but here we go. Now we're on that front line. This army is seriously... It looks a bit weird because of the skins, but it's all Immortals.
Yeah, yeah. Actually, someone brought up the same problem I had with that. Sometimes they do look like the Stalkers, But no, that is mass immortals. That's, of course, that's insane.
Just a reminder, players only see normal unskinned units in game, so there's no chance for confusion for them. Drogo very clearly sees 14 to 16 immortals in play, without a doubt. Upgrade's gonna finish up here soon. I'm not sure if we'll be soon enough for the battle. Showtime's about to have 3-2, which is gonna be a pretty big deal.
Drogo has 2 shields, didn't even notice that. That's pretty good for his Archons.
Yeah, absolutely. But we got that fight going down. Guardian shields pop off to try and reduce some of this damage, but the Zealots now on top of the Immortals. Even then, they don't give a good gosh darn. The barriers get popped, but now with the back flank, that might just be too much. The Archon account, kind of insane. 11 for Drogo, and I think he's about to crush Showtime's army.
I think so, but it ended up turning out, I guess, better than I expected. When Showtime had the Zealots, like, surrounding his Immortals, I thought it would be, like, 60 supply down. 30 supply is still pretty good for Drogo.
This is classic Drogo, by the way. Loses that first game, brings game back 2 in a spectacular fashion, and now we have this such a strange, very unique PvP on our hands.
Yeah.
Real quick, by the way, Real Jansoon in chat is the representative from Yord. He's finally joined us. He's got off his lazy Sunday butt. So if you guys have any questions about the Wood Watches, make sure to ask him. He's the one in charge of the giveaway as well for that $150 code.
Mm. The counterattack is not instant, but Drogo is one of the base up. So no matter what, he's going to keep that army supply lead and the upgrade lead. Again, I was talking about the Archon upgrades, the shield upgrades. That's actually pretty important because he did, as his army got pushed back, replace all those stalkers with Archons. And that definitely was the better composition to have against Showtime, since Showtime did overdedicate. Maybe if he wasn't surrounded, it would have gone better or washed or something like that. But it was still going to be problematic against mass charge lot Archon.
Oh, this is cute. He wants to catch up on a fifth, but he does it in a bit of a sneaky manner. That army supply deficit, though, even with all the overcharges and even with a cannon or two, it's gonna be really hard to actually do much to defend. He just blew all of his overcharges after all, so waiting this out. Drogo's up double the supply. Big warp is coming out of Showtime. He wants more Archons himself, but man, oh man, like, this is 13 Archons to 3. This is like watching the Immortals versus the Stalkers earlier, except now it's Archons and 29 Zealots versus everything for Showtime.
Yeah, this is insane. The Archons want to get that splash and the charge lots, and the Immortals, well, I mean, I guess they'd rather be hitting the Archons. I'm not even sure.
He's tending back to the best he can towards this choke. A Dark Shrine's on the verge of finishing up, and I don't believe there's detection on that front line, but even if there was or wasn't, I don't know DTs can kill anything here fast enough to save him in this game. I think Joker's done it. He's broken him over 13 Archons.
I love that this game ended up just being massing one unit and hoping it works.
Well, kind of. I mean, you consider, like, Showtime did make 16 Archons over the course of this game. He's just lost them in different rates in which Drogo had them made. So GG gets called and ties up the series now 1-1.
Woo.
Like,
oh, boy.
Like, seriously, I think Showtime, again, and Neep are my favorite players coming into this. If you didn't have respect from Drogo before, you gotta have it now. He's won 2 best of series leading into this, and he's playing very well versus Showtime in the third one. You'd think he'd be worn down by now, at the very least.
Mm-hmm.
But maybe people are just buying his shirts, and it's giving him power. Spirit Bomb style. Hell if I know. The HC Gaming makes a comment on our YouTube channel, by the way, and says, I'm not starting a fight like you said on stream, but I love that you put everything on YouTube. So, thank you. Thank you, sir. All right, guys, small break, but we'll get to game number 3. Don't go anywhere. We'll be back in 2 minutes. And, of course, just again verifying that the real Jansoon in chat is the Yord employee who hooked us up with Yord in the first place. So if you got questions, if you need answers, he's the guy to ask. All right, we're back and loading directly into the game. But real quick, before we get too far into the game, as we step into what is my favorite map of the reskin thing, Sarah's Station, just reminding you guys what the board currently looks like, as we are currently fighting here in the middle of the map for Rakshir, control of the middle and the center of the board. But spawning here on the bottom right side of Sarah's Station, it's going to be the red Protoss, Showtime of the Tal'Darim.
The top left as the blue Protoss, he is Drogo, the Templars.
Now, again, this is Runes of Ceres. It kind of gives you an idea, by the way, of when we started conceiving this map pool. Well, you know, when Runes of Ceres was still in it, was when we started thinking about making this thing happen. But reskinned entirely, again, the exact same map, same layout, same bases, same doodads and everything, except they've just been reskinned for Protoss. So instead of rocks at the bottom of the ramp, you've got a pylon. Mm-hmm. Funny enough, though, this is actually a matchup where you wouldn't have to worry about those blockers anyways. This was something really meant to stop Terran more than any of the other races.
Wait, what?
The blockers? The rocks?
It was meant to stop the pylon blocks. Well, I guess it's both, isn't it?
I guess nowadays it could possibly be more pylon blocks, but it really became like Terran, more Terran. Because I think more so than even seeing bunkers or anything else, it was the engineering bay blocks that were really stupid to look at. But regardless of the map, like, you could still, I guess, threaten nowadays with an overcharge. I don't think we see anyone break anyone quite like that, but...
It's been so out of the meta for such a long time because they started putting the blockers fairly early on, but there was the triple bunker...
Do you remember the triple bunker wall? Yeah, I was going to say wall offs on like Polar Knight and some of those other ones. Oh, gosh.
And then cannon rushes that would block off as well. So that's what I remember them as and why they needed those blockers. But it's just that they're never used anymore. Cannon rushes have fallen off. Bunker rushes aren't used anymore.
It's interesting to me that cannon rushes have fallen off, by the way, because there was this, I will say, about a 1 month spike in uptime for cannons were a combination ladder slash pros complaining about it on Twitter slash even seeing it once or twice in tournaments. Like, cannon rushing seems so viable because no matter what race you're playing against, the economy is so much better, faster. You could just afford more cannons and pylons than you used to be able to. But it got figured out pretty quickly and shut down pretty quickly. So we really don't see, like, who was that kid? Bubbles or whatever the fuck his name was. Like, you don't have any pro cannon rushers anymore.
Oh, that guy. Oh, the guy that beat at Coach Park. Yeah. I was going to say, because it was like Slayer's boner, because he cannon rushes.
Caliber,
he's not like one of those pro ones.
I feel like when we see Caliber play, by the way, his choice of strategy might just be dependent on how he feels. Like, I'm feeling a little fast and loose today. Let's try this. I don't care if it's good or bad. Let's just do it.
Yeah. No, I agree. Yeah, for sure. Well, this is Diagonal Spawn Ruins, and that means that it's going to take a while for any units to get across the map. We have one player going for an Oracle, the other player going for a Dark Shrine. I feel like it's been a while since we've seen these one base openers. Of course, they're still going to expand eventually, just, you know, you're going to have a lot of excess minerals, but point is, all starting on one base and all hoping not to be scouted. I think this Oracle would scout the Dark Shrine, though, before it finished.
As long as he doesn't stop to deal with the Adepts, which he may consider doing because of how hard this is to clean up. But no, he can rely on overcharges in the next round of Stalker, so the Oracle will go directly across the map. And on one hand, yes, you're going to see the Dark Shrine, but secondly, well, like, will you be able to react in time? There's going to be a pylon set up over here, and by showtime, it looks like it'll be a slow pylon, as I don't think we'll be seeing a gateway follow this up.
Mm.
But either way, warp-ins will come, and right now, okay, there we go, Robo starts. Mm. I like this.
With 3DTs warped in, you can kill a Robo for sure, but, you know, there's still going to be the Stargate option available, so there's going to be detection, but, you know, it's always a question of how much damage can they do. The Oracle actually goes in the wrong way, but still sees the Dark Shrine, so whatever. And with a slow warp in, that is enough time for him to try and prepare with the second Oracle.
So, hashtag sellout time. Hashtag no sellout. Okay. Real quick while the DTs come in. People are like, who even likes watches? Yo, at my high school reunion I went to this last weekend, guys, my watch seriously started, like, so many conversations. I really love the wood watches. And everyone thinks they're really neat when you show them off.
I've never really been one for your watches either. I was in that generation, I suppose, that had phones. But I thought that if there's going to be... I was going to wear a watch, it'd be a fancy one.
Yeah,
to,
something
like,
a little stylish.
Accent,
looks nice.
You know, yeah, exactly. Whatever. If I went to a wedding or something. That's exactly what it's been.
He just missed that second revelation, by the way. So the DT didn't get tagged by this. The Observer's on its way, though, so I don't think this will be too bad. Showtime getting about 5 workers killed. So Adept actually ends up getting the 6th one in the main. Not too bad.
Yep, not too bad. DT goes in, swipes, leaves. And I think saving that is definitely a better option. You know that there's multiple forms of detection available. It wouldn't do very much. So you wait until they're not looking, and then maybe they just won't have units in position. Not about the detection anymore. Double Oracles are still alive, though. They might not have a lot of energy, but eventually they will. And they could definitely do the same thing. Like, wait for Showtime to not have an army in his mineral line and kill quite a few probes.
Unfortunately, due to the revelations earlier, there's actually not a lot of energy on these. So even if they were to go in, they'd only be able to zap for about 3 seconds and then have to pull back again anyways.
They'd have to wait, for sure. Well, they actually don't, but, you know, that's why they don't get very many probe kills. Oh, and one even dies. Oh, well.
Another fair question in chat, by the way. How long till the giveaway? So, like we said, at most we'll probably do about 4 hours today, guys. Maybe we'll push it further if the players really want to, but there's about an hour... between now and an hour and 15 minutes from now is a good estimate of when we'll do the giveaway for that watch code.
It's getting a little awkward time because Lobal still isn't around with Top Dogs going on. He won't be fighting, and he is the last player, the player that's coming up next.
Well, Drogo moves all the pieces in. That's the whole point of why we appointed the team captain, so that like that wouldn't be an issue.
That wasn't my point. The point is that if we have to reset the turn order, then it might go to a point where, like, if the turn order restarts and there's three best of fives, they're all fighting over Rakshir, then we're going to have to stop the cast in the middle of a turn order again.
Well, that's fine, though, because we wrote it down last time and it went pretty smoothly. We just rerolled after it finished.
Yeah, I'm not saying it's a deal breaker, but it is just an awkward...
like... I hate it. I can never hear the word deal breaker without Liz Lemon in my head. It's a deal breaker, ladies.
Deal breaker. Yeah.
All right, so I love the attempt to go back in with the DTs. It's not going to get too much momentum, but still constantly harassing Drogo and keeping him at home while he takes his third behind this. Going to chrono out some probes and saturate that up ASAP. Oracle looking to dip around the main maybe once again. Did the second one actually get picked off? It looks like it did, so I wasn't paying attention.
It died. It died when we were looking at it.
Oh, okay, nice.
Yeah. Anyway, so I'm actually thinking about it. I wonder if the team captains probably are never going to think about this because it's not super duper important, and there's a chance it would work against them. But wouldn't in some cases you would want the turn order to restart or change? So you'd actually like...
Well, if you recall... fight. The last one leading into today, had we actually played that one extra turn, Harston would have followed up Showtime immediately instead of Drogo going first today.
Okay, so there are... I could see if they ever thought about it, like actually being like, no, stop the day so we can get like a new turn order for the next time we play.
Yeah, I think there's definitely going to be some strategical points where that would be more valuable, but that I think has a lot more to hinge on, like if your capital city is under siege or about to be attacked or something like that.
Yeah, that's true. Well, game theory aside, I suppose. Game board.
Board
theory,
game
whatever.
Theory, yeah.
Yeah, exactly. We finally have an attack going down. It's been pretty passive after the initial one base openers that did enough to really equalize, basically. And Showtime is looking to catch Drogo maybe in a bad position because the army supply isn't better or bigger. I guess it's an Archon.
Is it called a board game because of how passive it was?
No.
No. The force field should be able to push back the Immortals, and Showtime could ideally take a fight where he's not actually fighting the full strength of his opponent's army. But with the disruptors on the way, not only is that explosive damage, they also get to ignore force fields with their shots. So, kind of hitting a bit of a strict timing. Drogo also has plus one weapon upgrades, which is odd because it was Showtime who had it before.
Showtime going into a Stargate. It was Drogo that opened with a Stargate, but it's Showtime who's going to, I guess, use it for Phoenixes to pick up those disruptors again. He likes incorporating that. And he's going for that, charge that Immortal Archon. And he's always got that Dark Shrine. Well, if the game continues on a 4-3 bases, 4-5 bases rather, Dark Shrine could do a lot of damage.
Dark Shrine may or may not. What I'm finding most curious is the Stargate. He might be thinking to start Phoenixes to deal with the disruptors, which on paper sounds good, but in practice might not because of how late it's starting up.
That is a good point, but he has been hitting it pretty well. I don't think he thought Drogo would attack with only one or two disruptors. He only has one right now. And in that case, I don't even think it's that important to have a Phoenix to pick up that one disruptor. That's more just about dodging. Yeah, this first attack, and then you don't have to worry about it anymore. I like the hallucinated disruptors for Showtime, though. Trying to maybe trick Drogo into what composition he's going for. He's hiding the Phoenix once again.
I don't know why. I guess I thought you couldn't hallucinate disruptors for some reason, but I guess it would make sense that you could. Yeah,
I mean,
hallucinate Colossus, after all.
There are some units you cannot hallucinate.
Yeah, you can't hallucinate carriers. Really unfair, IMO.
Well, Showtime might be thinking the Phoenix is for the disruptor pickups, I think Drogo, with this being his second Stargate, might be thinking more into late game PvP. Or, I'm just waiting to see the sleep beacon.
Or it's hella meta, and he's thinking about the phoenixes picking up his thing, so he's going to go phoenixes for the phoenixes that are going to be picking up his disruptors. And then Showtime, recognizing this with a scout, will go for three stargates and go for phoenixes to get his phoenixes that are countering his phoenixes to pick up the disruptors. And at that point, Archons win.
Okay. Anyways, that was
it's
a roller
sad because it actually that's how that would go too, right?
Well, yeah. It's actually you might be correct. He still hasn't thrown on a fleet beacon. Gets double oracle. See, that would tell me he's going into Tempest, right? That gives him vision.
Right, yeah. But I actually love the idea of double oracle for harass a lot more than necessarily for scouting on things.
But why would you get double Stargate for it? I just build two oracles out of one Stargate.
I agree. I'm just saying I love the idea of going for the oracles like really quick. Nice pickup on the Warp Prism chest on four stalkers as well.
Hmm. Well, disruptors are still on the way for Drogo, so we didn't stop that completely. Just delayed the second Rogo for the second Stargate, which I'm still okay. Finally, the fleet beacon comes down. I was like, ah, man, I was really curious, but oh well. So if he gets a Tempest, he'll have that vision with the oracles, and he will accelerate the endgame PvP war, which Showtime will have to catch up on.
That was actually not that nasty of a hit. I thought it was gonna hit the Zealots, but it missed them. Only hits the Immortals. So of course, those can weather the hits. Phoenix is picking up these disruptors, ensure their death. Drogo still has a lot of army supply. Don't underestimate what's currently available on the map, but the disruptors being picked off are a pretty big deal. Let's also not forget those oracles aren't contributing much. They're going to be picked off by everything and anything. The Archons just reach out for them. Dark Archons look so cool for the Tal'Darim. Showtime's momentum has not been let up, even though he doesn't have a warp prism and no warpins on the front line. Drogo's actually going for Colossus of all things behind this.
That might be on purpose. We've seen a couple of experiments with Colossus, because the thing is, they'll add that consistent damage, but they just don't. It's not a lot of damage with only one or two Colossus, and it is a point where they're almost all maxed out, and it is going to be about terrible, terrible damage.
Well, Winter War is coming in. Some Sim City on those cannons is actually going to be really nice.
I don't know if Drogo has a good enough army for this. His charge odds are a little
Showtime.
Stuck.
I don't know if Showtime is a good enough army for this, just because he doesn't have reinforcements. Oh, wait, the Warp Prism's finally reached the front lines. Maybe that changes everything. Stalker's blinking on the left side. Archon's on the top, not really doing that much. The Guardian Shield's actually really helpful, so he focuses those down. And Drogo does actually take on Showtime's army, who did not reinforce a single unit during the whole fight.
Yeah, he didn't reinforce. The Blink Stalkers actually took on the non-immortal side of the army, and the Charge Lots did get unstuck from being behind the Archons. So that worked out really well for Drogo with that positioning.
Yo, can you unload up here, I'm wondering? Because there's no high... I got some other ship cores here, never mind. Let's get no high ground vision. If you could unload immortals on the top of this thing, that'd be so abusive.
I'm going to guess no. I think that has trees on it in the regular version, right?
Yeah. It looks like it's blocked off by the doodads here and here, but I just wasn't sure if we had like a case of dust towers on our hands or not.
You mean Deadwing?
Or Deadwing, thank you.
Yeah. Well, this is actually probably going to be game. Showtime pushed in with what looked like a very good composition against the majority of Blink Stalkers Drogo has.
Bloody Drogo. It's like a repeat of the last series, sincerely, with just different maps this time around.
Once Drogo's charge lots die, it's actually the complete reverse. Once again, those Blink Stalkers not too great against Archon Immortal.
The Colossus, though, he's actually very much intentionally just going for more Blink Stalkers, however. He's not too worried about the Immortals by the looks of it. I'm really curious about this Colossus, however. That thing should fall pretty quick, but not before getting some decent damage off. 10% attack speed. this is just a little too overwhelming, and while Immortals are really good, they're not going to be good enough. GG gets called, and Drogo will take a 2-1 lead. Oh my.
Get up Blink Stalkers, it works.
Yeah. It's like, you know, okay, you could have 5 Hellbats, but if there's 3,000 Zerglings, like, numbers will eventually win. This has been a great day of PvP so far. We're going to go to game number 4 shortly. Again, we'll see you guys in 2 minutes. Thanks for watching. All right, we're back. Somehow coming back caused me to cough. We're going to Star Station next for Game 4. This is Showtime's pick. This is also the two-player spawn version of Star Station, for those who do not know. And this has been very, very similar to the, I guess, pacing of that first best of five, but it's very different games, very different maps, of course.
Yeah. What happened on the last Star Station? Well, that might have been versus Puck. I don't think these guys played each other on this map. My brain's all foggy, it's fine.
Alright, well, welcome back to Yord's Civil War. Again, if you guys want to sign up for any of those cool giveaway codes, woodwatches.com/base. You gotta scroll all the way to the bottom to enter in, but you can win a $150 code. And like we said, the drawing will probably be give or take an hour from now. Really depends on what the next series ends up being. But currently, down by one game, playing for the Dal Darim and attacking into Rakshir, it's going to be the Red Protoss Showtime.
In the bottom right, as the Blue Protoss, he is my insanity's Drogo.
And of course, leading 2-1 is nice, but still not over yet. I mentioned attacking into Rakshir because that is the tile on the board they're currently playing on. Quickly, again, just out of the game for 1 second. This is going to be a little bit dire because this is center of the board control, which may not be in my strategy book to win this tournament, but seems to be in the player strategy books to win the overall tournaments.
I looked at the board really quickly to see the, you know, the current layout, and I thought someone was missing.
Someone just, like, disappeared. I'm out. Yeah. Peace.
Yeah, bye.
But no, people need me.
I didn't see Neeb at the bottom. All right, so, yeah, exactly. Like, this is going to be a very, like, I'm going to surprise the next one. No, that's Lil Bell, that's right. Well, whoever is next after Lil Bell, after Harstam, fight once again for Rakshir, because that's the way it's going. But this is, I guess, what we kind of had in mind through our test runs, you know? As you said, Fear Dragon was convinced people would just blitz to the middle, so that definitely convinced us to go for one movement point instead of two. I was convinced that a smarter plan, a more well-thought-out plan, could be taking the tiles.
Yeah, that's exactly what I would have gone for as well, and this comes from the experience of playing games like Shattered Galaxy and stuff. Land grabbing was actually a huge aspect of that game. So that's kind of my thoughts initially coming into this, but the players, I think, are just really focused on going gung-ho through the middle of the map.
As someone who loves playing Risk, but no one else does, I actually always over-dedicate. That's my problem. Risk is so bullshit RNG. Anyway.
Risk? For me, if they were to rename Risk, it would be your friend just turtles up in Australia and the game never ends.
I stopped playing the regular Risk board a long time ago when we got the futuristic one, and there, I don't think Australia still exists. It's called something different, at the very least.
They also, there's some versions which I really enjoy where they added kind of like quests, and if you got like 3 quests complete, you would win. So you didn't just have to dominate the world. Like, there's actually ways for it to end more than 5 hours from now.
Yeah, actually most Risk boards that are themed, like the StarCraft one or like Doctor Who ones or whatever, actually aren't just like reskinned Risk boards. They actually have their own element to the game. So the futuristic one, you could have nukes, you could take over the moon, you could take over the sea.
So
it was cool.
Speaking of that, there is a StarCraft 2 Risk Collector's Edition board game.
Hey-o.
That we had signed by everyone, Adrian McLaughlin. We even had the casters and some of the folks from Blizzard sign it. That's still up for raffle, guys. The 19th is when we'll draw the winner for the Arcade Block thing. So if you guys haven't subscribed to Arcade Block, you've still got time to do it. Just remember to screenshot your proof of purchase so that we can enter you into that raffle.
I forgot that Mike Moreham was there, and I got him to sign it.
Dude, I thought it was really cool. Again, like, I know I talked about it before, but seeing his name in the Warcraft credits was really super nerdy. And I guess, like, I probably wouldn't care normally, but because we met him and he's such a nice guy, it was really awesome to see his name up there on the big screen.
He really is. Well, Showtime is looking to apply a little bit of pressure. We definitely saw this the last time we saw Star Station, even though that was in a different best of.
Ooh.
And Drogo made the mistake of pushing out here.
Yeah, this is all too familiar. I'm having hardcore deja vu, but instead of this revolving around thirds, it's as if the natural just got broken, which did not happen when Puck was defending. This is snowballing.
He defended with a few more units and a probe pool, but then was still like behind the entire game.
Yeah.
So this is even worse for Drogo, who I don't even think a probe pool would help. He's going to try and counter.
He's going to lose the Nexus. That's not... Nope.
It's probably game, but we'll see what Drogo's Warp Prism can do. He does have 3 gateways coming up, but they're still not ready, and he would need the warp-ins really quickly here. Unless Showtime makes the mistake of warping in offensively still after already killing the Nexus.
That's very true. He's got a couple of overcharges, though. I mean, this mothership, of course, got a lot of energy. That'll buy time for that disruptor to pop out, which looks like he's going for. He's also hesitant to use much. Money being spent on buildings more than actual units right now.
If Drogo could warp into the dead space, he could just completely surprise Showtime. If he has four stalkers, he could probably just try and snipe the Mothership Core before she gets all of her overtures down. But that's actually two sentries, three sentries, and a stalker. Still, right on top of the Mothership Core, so even with the tickle sentries, almost gets it.
Oh my god. And of course, with the sentries, he can't walk up that ramp anymore. This is really problematic as Showtime goes back home. Drogo.
Uh-oh.
Nexus stalls out the disruptor.
Oh my god, can he really do
it? If his warp prism could wrap around, he could maybe pick up the stalkers and bring them up, but he's going to try and retreat out, but the force field's going to go down and say, nope, I don't think so.
Yeah, exactly.
Oh my god. Oh my god, he force field's in all the probes, they're going to die. No escape from this. Showtime in a lot of trouble, and Drogo, oh my god, he might just do it here in game number four.
I think he just might have. It's already 24 probes to 12, so the second Nexus is like, you know, Showtime now.
He's going
to
miss the force fields on that ramp.
Okay, that's problematic. There's no pylons to overcharge. The Mothership Core is going to have the tiniest bits.
So this one, like, all the probes are going to go down. Like, all the probes are going to go down. So even if he has to fall back off this on one base, it's better than two bases and no probes.
Yeah, I guess I could kind of help with the maybe.
I mean, there's no pylons. Why not? You can't overcharge anything anyways.
Wow, one probe left over and his army is dying.
The Warp Prism Micro is going to try and help, but I don't think it's going to be enough. Showtime knows it as well. GG! Drogo 3-0 and scores today. Cannot be touched. Now, I mean, it's 3-1 here for this, but he's won all three of his matches played on the board. And a literal Protoss god right now. So, that goes off. Showtime goes back home, and Drogo defends. This guy is seriously badass. Zombie Grub.
Drogo is on a hot streak, but unfortunately he can only go so many times, so it's still up to his teammates to help him.
Who's left in the churn before we decide when the day ends today?
Lil Bow.
Just Lil Bow and that's it?
Yep.
That starts over. Alright, we're going to go to a break. We're going to talk with the players and see if they want to end it early or if they're willing to go a little bit later. Because basically, I don't think we're going to have a best of three. It'll probably be another best of five. Drogo might attack in a puck type thing is the only other thing I can see perhaps happening, but what's the churn order? Harston, Puck, Drogo. So yeah, chances are we'll see Drogo under attack and Rakshir. So we'll take a break and then we'll ask the players what they want to do, whether they want to go longer, a little bit longer. I mean, it's a weekend, but it's late in Europe, or whether they want to stop early. We'll be back in a few minutes, though, guys. Thanks for watching the Civil War, and stay tuned, because if we end it early, we'll be drawing the code for the watches ASAP. So be back in a few. All right, folks, so we need to talk about what's going on. This is a kind of delicate point of the game. We've told the players so that they're fully aware next time we're going to start introducing sudden death elements. Small things like, for example, moving twice per turn instead of once and removing some limitations, which will continue to get more and more crazy later. Harstam, we'll pick the decision in a second, but Drogo, as the last turn on this cycle, has moved Little Bow back to the capital. So now it's up to Harstam and his team whether they want to start a brand new cycle or if they want to end it all right now. Okay. And it looks like they're going to end it now. So this means today's event will come a little bit short, but I think we got some really good games out of it, to be certain. Two best of fives and a best of three. Not too bad at all. And we'll go to day four for the next one. So here is the public announcement of like what is for sure happening. Again, I can't tell everybody too much because we don't want the players to know ahead of time. But next time we come back, players will be able to move twice per turn instead of just once. So, for example, Little Bow, who can right now, from the capital, only move to Orbital Shipyard or Ruins of Saris or Star Station, could instead be able to go to Orbital Shipyard, then Preon Terraces, then attack into Habitation Station and grab it for free. So you can see how big of a difference that's going to make. That's one turn instead of like two and a half. So next time we come back, things should be sped up a little bit. And if day four still doesn't have a victor, then we'll move that up even further with other elements. But looks like that will end Civil War day three. So I'm going to take a quick screenshot of the board because this is where we're going to end at. And we've been updating the team Lookathread with the results of all these days. It's been pretty cool to see. And I hope you guys have enjoyed it so far. So, again, the tournament could still go on 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 days, all depending on how good players are at deflecting one another. But I really love that this has been going so every time we stress test the mod, it works. No problems with skins, no problems with, like, lag. It looks good on the stream. The board game has been pretty fun, I gotta say. So, just again, thank you guys for all joining us so far. But hang on, since we have some I'm going to see if I can get any of the players to come on and just give some feedback on how they think about the tournament. Maybe some ideas. Because we're talking a lot about, like, from our point of view, right? Like, what we like to see, and we know what the fans like to see. But I'm curious about the players' point of view. So we're going to see if we can grab any of these guys to come on stream and talk for, like, maybe 2 or 3 minutes. Maybe they all just want to go to bed. And if they do, that's totally fine. It's like 1 o'clock here for me, but like midnight or later over there, I'm sure.
It's 11 or something like that. Me, you know, also want to take a nap, midday nap. Yeah.
Oh, I'm jealous, man. I used to take a bunch of midday naps, and I'd just go out walking all the time, trying to exercise, and I miss my naps. Naps are amazing.
Oh. I love the heat. Like, I mean, I hate it when I'm on my way back and I'm like sweaty and gross, but I love when it's like 90 degrees outside. So good.
All right, well, looks like Hearthstone maybe wanted to join us, guys. Let's just hop to the board game real quick while I add these guys to the call, and it will absolutely mess everything up.
And I don't know if this is like very, very, very mild reaction to allergies or whatever, but my eyes are tired.
It's the sympathy allergies coming in again, man.
It's not seeing this time, it's eyes.
All right, cool. And looks like Drogo will join us as well as Harstam. Cool. So just add these guys to the call and set screen regions. We'll swap the scene back over.
Hello.
So we're not going to play ads or anything. Hey, what's up, Harstam? How's
Hello.
It going, man?
Well, not as good as it was before.
No, apparently not. Drogo is like untouchable today, dude. What the hell?
Yeah, he went 3-0, no?
Yeah, against Showtime twice, which really blows me away. Showtime made Neeb look like nothing. I thought Showtime was the god.
Yeah, he is. He still is. But yeah, I was surprised as well. The first series was very close. The second series, it felt like Showtime had good chances in every game. He was very far ahead most games, even, or else some of the games. I thought the Dust game and the last game, I really didn't see him lose. Like, I couldn't see him lose that. And then in the first series, there was the Orbital game.
Yeah.
He was in a very good spot as well there.
Yeah, it looked like he got spooked or choked or something. It was really awkward.
He got Drogo'd. That's even worse.
He got Drogo'd. Okay. Well, hopefully Drogo will pick up and join us. I'll take us to the screen here. You can see Harsim's lovely face, at least, staring away up at the nothingness. But, so you've had 17 shirts sold so far. Drogo sold 13. First question I just got on aspect of this is, are you more focused on winning the tournament or more focused on selling more shirts? which is gonna feel better for a victory?
Oh, the tournament for sure. I think we if we have a few more days like this, then we're going to have to switch to the shirt competition, because Drogo just played extremely well today. So but of course we're aiming to win the tournament.
Oh, there's Drogo. Bonjour.
Hello. Bonjour.
All right, so Drogo, we got a lot of bullshit to ask, but I got to ask you this one first. How are you feeling today, dude? Holy fuck. Like, Jesus, you're a monster.
I don't know, to be honest. I think I got extremely lucky. But today I played some StarCraft 2 before playing the tournament. So maybe
that makes the difference for actually practicing.
Yeah, I was well warmed up. So.
Well, it definitely showed, man. I mean, taking on somebody like Showtime, who is such a good player in the first place, and twice in a row, no less, that's really impressive.
Yeah, but I don't think I could do it.
Not a third time?
The way I won most of these games were pretty fucking funny.
Well, okay, I gotta ask you guys both this question before we talk about the nitty-gritty stuff. This tournament's obviously a little bit different in style. It's not brackets, it's a board game. I mean, it's something where it's a practice session, and it's, I'm sure, things to be perfected, but are you guys enjoying it so far? Is it okay? Is it weird? Like, give us some honest feedback on this.
Should I start? Or I'll just start.
Sure, yeah, you start with yours.
I think it's the only downside is that you have to wait for very long times before you get to play. And sometimes you don't even get to play at all. So today I didn't get to play. I guess that was also a bit out of choice. But I remember the first day that Showtime didn't get to play, and today none of the other players of the other team actually got to play. So, and I think it's a bit too focused around Rakshir as well. Like Rakshir, the best of five, I feel like that can be a bit much, especially if you have to play someone twice, you know? What happened now? Showtime got knocked back to the capital, and he can immediately attack Rakshir again. I think that's, like, if you have to play two best of fives in a row against the same player, that's a bit long, I think. That's the only downside I see. But I really like the board game aspect, and I think the rules need to be fine-tuned a little bit. Like, they need to be a little different.
Yeah.
To speed up the game and to maybe change certain things. But I'm not sure what or how, but some things don't feel right, like what I just mentioned.
Well, to address that really quick before we get Droga's opinion, we had done practice sessions on this because, you know, we just played amongst ourselves with, like, a board, and we didn't play these huge, long hour-and-a-half PvPs and stuff. It was about 3 days worth of sessions that it ended because somebody just blitzed across the map and there just wasn't really a lot. This is going a lot more back and forth than we had thought it would, so definitely the rules, for certain, I agree, need to be adjusted around it. But that's where some of these things, like the quote-unquote sudden death, like each day after this, we're going to have things go specifically designed to speed it up. Like, for example, we announced on stream the first one's going to be next time we come back to play, people can move twice. So, for example, right. Little Bell can actually get around the map much quicker, and you guys may not have to focus on the middle of the map because you can actually go around
type thing. Yeah, for sure.
I definitely want to fine-tune this and make this perfect, but I think the other thing I would do in retrospect is make the board bigger, so it's not just this one column that is the biggest, like that one centerpiece is the focus.
Yeah, I agree. I think that would be a good thing, making the board bigger.
What are your thoughts on this so far, Jogo? About the same?
Yeah,
or?
Just the same thing, that the entire team has to stay on, like, on standby, waiting for the games to be done while really not doing anything. It's like you can't even, like, play ladders while the overmatch is going on, because it's PvP, it can end, like, very, very, in a very short amount of time. And then you're late for when people call you because you're in a game. Just the fact that you do nothing while watching over play is not optimal, I guess.
I guess,
compared to, like, a normal tournament. Yeah.
I know we had discussed as well when we were talking about the stress of scheduling the potential replays and things, and just I guess that might be a little bit more alleviating to that as well, so that you can actually play a game and not be on standby for so long. But okay, that's great points for us to have to improve for if we ever try and do this again. I mean, I'm finding this to be quite fun, and it's much different than the bracket system, so I'm enjoying it and would love to try and perfect it, but obviously regular brackets work perfectly fine, and we'll probably see a majority of those here on the channel, guys. But Jorgo, you sold a couple of shirts today, man. I gotta say, like, I don't know if it was the victories or people just wanted to support you or what the deal was, but that's gotta feel pretty good. What are your thoughts on this outside aspect? Not the tournament itself for the moment, but the idea of being able to sell stuff for players.
Are you asking me if I like making more money?
Well, I mean, the answer to that's clearly going to be yes. But I mean, for example, if you were to turn on your stream, you're not going to have the viewership we would. But hopefully, ideally with this, we can help kind of bridge that difference, right? Like, we sell something for the players to help them earn some extra money. Is this something you wish more tournaments would do? Or is this kind of like, this is a little bit too sellout-y for me? Or where do you land on that?
Oh, I think it's fine. Like, I agree. It can look a bit sellout, but I feel like the StarCraft 2 community in that regard is always very, very hyped about this kind of thing, compared to, like, other community where they would go, like, all sellouts.
Yeah.
I don't know. Like, this is a weird point I'm making, but I feel like in the StarCraft 2 community, it's more than okay. I don't know. I don't know where I'm going with that, but I think it's fine.
Okay. And what about you, Arsim? Same sort of idea. Do you wish it'd be more possible to do stuff like this on the regular, or is the shirt thing like a good just one-time-only thing?
No, seems fine for me. Like, I don't really see the downside, you know? Yeah, only positives. I'm not sure what would be a downside.
Well, there's like, for those who don't know, by the way, tuning in, there's like legal issues and other things on the outside that could make this a downside, but luckily we've got very nice people working with us on this, so it's just hopefully going to benefit the players in every way possible.
Yeah.
But okay, so with things like the movement speed changing and a couple other unannounced changes coming, the rate this is going is definitely a lot slower than we thought, which isn't necessarily a bad thing. But with a $1,600 prize pool, this will be the last question I have for you guys and let you go. The prize pool is about $1,600-ish right now, 70% to the winning team, 30% to the losing team. How do you feel on the game-to-money ratio? Like, is this all right? Is this about that sweet spot of normal? Do you feel like it's going to go way too long? Or we'll start with you, Harston. What do you think on the money-to-games ratio with this format?
It depends a bit what you compare it to. But I think it feels a bit long, especially if you're the losing team. Normally, if you lose, you're done very fast, you know? But now you don't know until a very long time if you will be the loser or not. You get what I mean?
Yeah, I can see that. Yeah.
Normally, it kind of ramps up with the amount of time spent and the amount of money you're gonna earn, unless it's like a go for StarCraft 2 or whatever. So I think it's, if you're winning, it's fine. If you're losing, it probably will feel like you used a lot of time for a lot less return.
Well, I ask this because, first off, I mean, the losing team's going to get money no matter what. So I don't think anyone's walking away here completely empty-handed. But, for example, we've had a lot of feedback from some players that, for example, Ting has too many games. And it's just ridiculous trying to even get to that round of eight. And in my eyes, you play less games than this so far compared to that. But, I don't know, Drogo, what are your thoughts? Too many games? Just enough games? Where do you sit on that spectrum?
I feel like the tournament, the PvP one, is below average in terms of cash per game, especially when you're used to like win 6k for one best of five. But
feels bad, man.
I don't know. There's not that many online tournaments that give money that we can afford to be picky, you know? Even if the ratio is bad, I feel like it will be a bit... I don't know the word in English, but it would be a bit bad to just say, I have to play too many games, I'm not doing it.
Well, so. For us, I mean, this is about perfecting it, too. Like, we don't want to have players feel like they're dragging their heels every time we throw an event. So it's good to know your thoughts on this. So thank you. That being said, though, I don't want to keep you guys all day, so we'll just finish this up. Any final thoughts or comments, Harstam, shout-outs, or anything before you go?
Yeah, buy the shirt, boys. Buy the shirt.
Find the shirt. He's currently winning, guys. 17 shirts for Harstam, 13 for Drogo. What about you, Drogo? Any final things before we go?
I think you should buy the shirt of the winning team. And yeah, buy my shirts, not his shirts. Thank you.
I just made a general statement. You gotta make it some racial tension again, Drogo.
Dude, Drogo's tweeting out pictures of you, thermal man. I'm just saying, this guy's all kinds of like StarCraft racial right now.
Yeah, that's insane.
I laughed my ass off seeing that picture, by the way, when you tweeted that.
It's a good tweet. I'm proud of that one.
All right, well, thank you guys both for joining me, and thanks for giving us this extra couple minutes. We'll find out when the schedule is for the next day, guys, because a lot of this has to do with, like, you know, with Homestar Cup coming up and DreamHack's on the way and stuff. We want to make sure that these guys aren't stressed and they can kind of play, I don't know, weekend leisurely or something like that. But thank you both for joining us today for day three of the Civil War, and we'll see you guys later.
Yeah, see ya.
Bye.
Bye-bye.
Okay, I'll get Zongrip to recall me, and we are going to restart the stream with no delay so that we can... Oops, let me join this. Hello? We're going to restart the stream with no delay so we can give the codes away, the winner of the coupon code in real time. Because we learned last time doing it at 3 minutes on delay makes it take like 20 minutes to give away the code. So we'll play this last set of ads while we restart the stream. Please stick around, guys. If you want to buy those shirts for the players, for the teams, just go to teespring.com/teamdrogo or Team Harstam, or just go to teespring.com/store/civilwar, or more easily than that, !! Teespring in chat. Last but not least, before we actually do lose you all, make sure to check out the Yord. You can still, between now and when the stream comes online, you could still enter in for the giveaway. So go to woodwatches.com/base, fill out the form, request the $20 code, and with that $20 code, enter in your Twitch name, because that will be what enters you in for the $150 code we're about to announce the winner for. So stay tuned, guys, and we'll see you in a few minutes.